days of the whole year when we all get up early. I have so much time. I'm going to have an extra cup of coffee.
Yeah, after that cat.
Oh, I know. The cats don't know. And the little kids don't know. Yes, they go off at the normal time, don't they?
Yeah, what can be about to go away, you know?
That's right. Well, it's a blessing to have all of you here with us today. It's the 25th Sunday of Pentecost. And I'm just blessed by that music. I had the sense, we do this every week. We've been doing this for years and years. And suddenly I was like, I think God hears us. You know, even just how many people, 65, so many people in this room, I think God hears us when we sing. And that was awesome. So thank you. We've been sharing prayer requests this week because you talked to me or you sent me an email or text or phone call. And so I thought your joys would be strength from there and also from the sheets at the back of the room. So, and thank you, kiddos, for filling out your kid sheet as well. So let us be in the spirit of prayer, hearing all of our prayers. And now we ask that you would hear us as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. It's time for the children to come forward.
He will come looking for us just like he looked for the sheep.
job, guys. Thanks for helping. Okay, so I hope you're going to have a really good time learning the song to sing for us next week. We look forward to it.
Yay!
And many of you have 2 days off school this week, don't you?
Yay!
Lord God, thank you that you follow, look for us just like you looked for the lost sheep. And we ask that you would help us always come back home to you. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Yay!
Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity.
Today's scripture lesson comes from Hosea chapter 2, verses 19 through 23. Israel, I will make you my wife. I will be true and faithful. I will show you constant love and mercy and make you mine forever. I will keep my promise and make you mine, and you will acknowledge me as Lord. At that time, I will answer the prayers of my people Israel. I will make rain fall on the earth, and the earth will produce grain and grapes and olives. I will establish my people in the land and make them prosper. I will show love to those who were called unloved, and to those who were called not my people, I will say, you are my people. And they will answer, you are our God.
For the sermon this morning, I've chosen to do a first-person narrative, leading a character narrative. But I wanted to assure you that this is a Bible story. This is a rendering of the book of Hosea, who's one of the 12 prophets at the end of the Bible. So this is a Bible story with a little bit of embellishment, but not my own story. That would be the most effective way to present it. So before we begin, let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for your scriptures, which are so ancient and yet so applicable because of the power of your Spirit to speak into our lives today. God, we ask that you would be with each of us as we hear and consider this story. We ask that you would be with me and help me to think and to speak clearly. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. I ask Daniel for a little costume change. some things have changed. I mean, look at my house. Look at me. Nice little tidy little house. Oh my gosh, I gotta sit down. These shoes are killing me. I can't do this anymore. These are like the only, I mean, aren't they wonderful? Look at them. Look at them. They're like the only things I had from back in the old days. You know what I'm saying? But I had to keep them because they're so pretty. Of course, I didn't used to have to walk as far. They used to say those shoes only need to walk from the closet to the bed, my darling. But I can't. Anyway. But look at me here. In this house, this nice little tidy house. You know, it's so respectable. Me and Mama, three little kitties, and you know, a husband and a wife. Imagine that. You wouldn't think a girl like me would come out like this, would you? Well, I mean, I guess I'll tell you the story. Some of you know about it, and I gotta get out of these shoes. I'm sitting back down. I'll tell you the story, though, because it really is something. I shouldn't be here. I shouldn't, by all rights. But, well, when I was a little girl, you can tell that I'm not from here, can't you? I'm from down south. I'm from southern Israel. And my parents, they moved up here when we were just, I was just little. And they were looking for more opportunity for our family. We're pretty poor down there. And we got up here, and I tell you that, you know, it just wasn't much better. It was hard. My mom kept having babies, and we didn't have a whole lot of money. And when I was about 12 years old, my mom said to me, Gomer, we can't afford you. And it's about time for you to get married. And she said, we don't know who you marry. We don't have anything to give a husband for you. And so she said, I'm going to take you to live with a new lady in a new house. And you'll like her real well. Her name is Madam. And so they took me there. And I was mad and I was sad. And but that's just the way it was. And I guess over time I kind of understand. But anyway, so I started working there with a whole bunch of girls who were in my same situation. And, you know, I mean, I guess the work was a little upsetting at first, but what are you going to do? I mean, you just get used to it. And I'll tell you what allowed me to keep going was those other girls. They were like sisters. We went through this together. You know, we built each other up. It was a really hard life, but we had each other so that we could hold on to each other. And we could get together with our fancy shoes, and Matt would give us wine, and we could party, you know, and kind of feel good just for a moment, just for a little bit. You know, take the edge off of that. But then we wake up in the morning and feel pretty empty again. You know, it's pretty hard not to feel bad about yourself when your parents give you up and when you have to be a whore for a living. But that's what we did, and that's what I did. And I tried to be happy when I could be happy. And so I held on to my girls, and we had fun, and we partied, and it was great. We had fun. And then one day, Madam comes to me, and she said, Gomer, there's someone here to see you. And I said, oh, it must be one of my regulars. You know, I wonder which one this one is. Should I get over it? And so I went over there and I looked, and this is a man I haven't seen before. And I said, hello. And he said, hello, what is your name? And I said, my name is Gomer. What is your name? And he said, my name is Jose. I said, okay. And what would be your pleasure, Mr. Jose? And he says, Gomer, I would like for you to be my wife. I want you to come home with me. I want you to marry me. And I said, I'm sorry, Mr. Jose, you kind of got this. You must be new at this, because we don't have to get married to do the things that you want to do. You already paid, didn't you? And he said, no, Gomer, I would like you to be my wife. I want you to come home. He said, I already talked to Madam about it. She said that that was fine, and so why don't you come home with me? Now, I did not trust this, and so I went and talked to Madam. I said, what's going on? And she said, well, you know, it's kind of funny, but I think this guy is all right. I do. I know about him a little bit, and he's one of the guys who goes to the temple most days. And I think he's okay. And I thought about it. You know, I used to stand out in front of the house, you know, sometimes when things were slow, waiting for the next customer. And I would look, you look down the street where we live, you look down there, there's a main street that's going to the temple. And I used to look, and I would see people carrying their things to the temple. They would have like baskets of crops and stuff, things that they had made. They were going to give to God and, you know, be all holy. You got to be really holy to go to the temple. And they would go with their baskets and they would go say some prayers. And I remember thinking, I'm glad our house is this far. that much closer, it would be like lightning would strike or something, you know? And so they would go to the temple and they would, you know, they would make themselves feel all good, you know? But I'm gonna tell you the truth though, because sometimes those same men who would be going up to the temple like all pious, you know, I'm gonna offer my sacrifice to the Lord, they would stop at tomorrow's for cooking on the way home, they would. So not everybody who went to the temple is okay. You know what I found out too? You go in there, you make your prayers, you give your offering. You gotta be good to do that. But there is even a center part of that temple, the holy, holy, holy part, and only some super holy people can go in there sometimes and make prayers on just some days of the year. I mean, it's just crazy. You have to be really, really good to get into there. And so when Madam said this to me, I thought, I wonder if he's one of those holy, holy, holy guys, you know? But anyway, she said he was all right. And then she said, you can go home with him. Go home. Give this a chance. I've got a good feeling about this, she said. But if he's bad to you, if he's hard on you, you just come right back. You just run away and you just come right back. And we will take care of you. And so I did. I went home with him. And I honestly, I was like standing over here like this. I thought, oh man, what's the other shoe going to drop? You know, maybe he's into some really weird stuff and I just don't know why I'm here. And, but he was really good to me. You know, he showed me the house, showed me around, and he said, you know, I'm going to give you some money, and then you can go, and I want you to be a wife for me. I want you to make the house, I want you to cook the food, and, you know, maybe we'll have some babies someday, and things like that. And time went on, and it was fine. That's what he was doing. And he would go off to the temple and talk to his friends and stuff, and somebody even told me one time, they said, I think that Jose is a prophet. He's somebody who, like, speaks for God sometimes. For me. I thought, okay, whatever, he's nice to me, whatever he does. And so we were there, and it was working out, and I kind of started to trust him a little bit more. I said, Hosea, why did you do this? Why did a nice man like you go to the temple almost every day, who you call a prophet, why did you marry a whore? That does not make sense to me. And he looks at me just so serious, just like he was that first day I met, and he said, Gomer, I married you because God told me to. Well, that holy, holy, holy God told you to marry me? I was like, okay, that's not the God that I know of, but okay, that's what he said. He said he did. He wanted me to show the people that God loves the people even when they are unfaithful. And you are an example of being unfaithful. I thought, thank you very much. But I guess that's kind of true. He said, I did it to show the people. I said, okay. So time went on and we had some babies. We had a little boy. Jose was really particular. He said, I have got to name this baby. God told me what to name this. Okay, name the baby. And we had a little girl. Same day, I got to name the baby. Jose was really big about names. He just went on and on and on. Fine. So little boy, little girl, another little boy. You know, boom, 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 they were all in a row, about 4 years. And I had these four little babies at home toddling around. And I don't know, about that time, I guess I started to get a little bit lonely. I think the word got out in the neighborhood about what I used to do. And I think that the ladies, they just would not spend time with me anymore. They did not want to go shopping with me anymore. They didn't want kids to play together. And so I was pretty lonely. And, it's hard when you have tiny little babies. They wear you right out. They get up early on the morning all the time. And I was lonely and I was bored. And I started thinking back about, you know, my sisters at Mount House. And I think I kind of forgot about the bad parts of that life. But, you know, I just remember the parties. I remember the shoes. I take these shoes out and I look at them. And I said, that was really fun. And I wasn't alone there. And I was really in a low spot. And it was right at that time that a couple of my girls came by. They found out where I lived, and they came by. And they said, Gomer, look at you. Look at all this. Look at how you're playing housewife. You're playing like you're a nice lady. Playing like you're a good girl. You know you're not a good girl. And I guess deep down inside, I guess I felt like I was always kind of pretending. And they said, you know you're not a good girl. You know that you're bored, you know that you're lonely, and you know that it'd be fun. They said, do you have any wine around here? I said, no, we don't have any wine. Well, come on with us. You're gonna have fun. Come on. Adam, I just went. I just went. I ran away. I said, I'm pretending. This isn't really who I am. I'm not somebody that somebody marries because they want to show what God does in the world. I'm not a good wife. I'm not a good housewife and mother. This isn't what I amount to. I knew that from the very beginning. I knew what I was worth from the very beginning when my parents gave me up. And so I went back where I thought I belonged. And I went there and the man said, she said, Gone? Has he started to treat you bad? After all this time, after 4 years, he started to be bad to you? And I said, no, ma'am, but I just don't belong here. That's just not who I am. I'm just not a good wife. I'm one of the girls, you know what I mean? That's who I am, I'm here to party. And she said, Gomer, that is the stupidest thing I ever heard. She said, you are not as smart as you look. She said, I cannot believe that you gave up on an opportunity with a man like that. You had a chance, she said. She said, I'm so mad at you and I can't let you come back in this house because if you come back in this house as a woman who has had children, who's been out there living a different life, you're gonna put on airs, you're gonna act like you're better than the other girls and I can't have it. She said, I had a man come through here yesterday looking to buy a wife. And I'm going to sell you to him because I cannot have you here. And just like that, she found me. And she sold me to this very bad man. He was not looking for a wife. He was looking for a slave. And so I went to his house and that wasn't very good. I found that out right away. He kept me on a very tight leash, and I couldn't really get out. I couldn't think about running away, and it was pretty bad. He did let me go out in the house. There's kind of a yard, and he let me go out there, and I like to plant a garden. My mom had taught me how to do that a long time ago in southern Israel, so I planted a garden, try to just do something, you know. So I was working on that. I've been there about 3-4 months, and I looked down the road. One time I'm down there in the dirt, and I look down the road, and I'll tell you what, it looked like it was Hosea coming. It looked like Hosea, and I was like, what is he doing over here? Because this isn't even our side of the town. And that's not him. And I looked a little bit harder, and he was coming. I thought, oh my God, I cannot let him see me. I am so embarrassed. I'm ashamed. I don't want him to know. And so, I don't want him to know about this man. I don't want him to know that I'm here. I want him to forget about me. And so I ran around the house, around the back, and just tried to hide from him. And then out in the front of the house, I'm not even going to talk about the name of the man. My husband was out in the front of the house, and I thought, oh my God, don't let Hosea see that man. Don't let them talk. Don't let them get in touch with each other at all. And I said, Lord, please, no, 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 no. And Hosea walked right up to him and started talking. And I said, what is that about? What are they talking about? So here's me going through the house like this, you know. I'm going to go listen at the window just like this. What does he say? I hear my name. And then I'm at the door, you know. I got to listen a little bit more. And Hosea said, Gomer, is that you? And I said, yeah, yes, it is. And he said, come here, please. And I thought, oh, boy, now I'm really going to get it because I ran away and I belonged to him first and this is going to be bad. And I stood there and he said, Gomer, I want you to come home. I'm here to buy you back. And I thought, what? And he talked to that man and he said, I want to buy her back. And he said, well, she belongs to me and you're going to have to pay a big price for her now. You're going to have to pay double what she's worth. And Jose said, okay. And he said, well, in that case, you can pay triple what she's worth if you're so full of money like that. And Jose said, okay. And he took out his bag and he paid 3 times the price to buy me back. I can't even tell you how I felt. I was so embarrassed and I was so relieved. And I just started walking down that road with him to walk home and I didn't have a word to say. I didn't know what to say. I just was filled with all these emotions and I finally, I said to him, Hosea, why did you do that? And he looked at me just real serious, just like he had that first time when he talked to me. And he said, Gomer, I bought you back because God told me to. And I said, can you explain to me, like, do you think you're hearing God okay? God told you to go and marry a whore, and you did, and she ran off, and you should have known that you heard God wrong in the first place. That isn't real smart. And now you think God said to go buy her back. And Jose said, no, I did hear God correctly, and I was supposed to buy her back. And I said, well, why? And he said this. He said, well, God called me to show people how God loves them. And God loves people even when they worship other gods, even when they're promiscuous, he said. So God told me to marry a promiscuous woman. He said, he went on about this history. I'm not very educated in all the history stuff, but he said, the people from the Israelites, when they were in Egypt and they were slaves, and God brought them out, and then everybody was like, oh, good God, we love you, we love you. But then they kind of turned away and started worshiping other gods. And that made God feel like Israel was promiscuous. So here's Hosea. I want to marry a promiscuous woman to show that God still loves Israel when Israel's promiscuous. Okay, fine. But why'd you come back and get me when I went wrong? And he said, because even when we run away from God as a nation, that God still would pay anything to have us back. He would pay any price. And so I would have paid any price to get you back. And I thought, man, I just don't deserve this, do I? I don't deserve this at all. And it made me think, you know, it's true with nations. What Hosea is saying, what he said to me got through to me, it's true what he says about nations, that when nations turn away from God and when they forget who God is, that God really wants them back so much and is just looking for them. Maybe like a shepherd who looks for a sheep, or maybe like Hosea who looked for me. And then when a nation turns away from God and forgets who God is, that God is always so glad to have us back when we come back, when he finds us. I wonder if you live in a nation where people have turned away from God and where people have started to worship other gods. And I just want you to know that if you do, that God wants us back. God wants us back. So those words really got into my heart that time, and I came back to the house and I felt different. I felt like, you know what, this is a plain house, and this is sort of a plain life, and I just am a mom with three little kids around, and I cook food, and I keep the house nice, and maybe it's boring compared to what we did, you know, down in Madeline's house. But I want to tell you something. When you do things like that, when you say, well, I feel bad, so I'm going to party tonight, and I'm going to go out, and I'm going to just have a good time, and I'm going to drink my wine, and I'm going to, you know, do what I do, and it's going to be awesome. Yeah, it feels good. Yeah, just for a minute, doesn't it? It does. It makes you feel good. I'll admit it. I've been there. I did it over and over again. But when you wake up in the morning, you still feel like you're not worth anything. The only thing that can make you feel like you are worth something is if you know someone has paid a price for you. And Hosea paid a price for me. And that has made me know that I am worth something. So when the girls came by this time and they said, hey, Gomer, let's go out, let's party, let's have a good time like before, I said, well, let me talk to my husband about it. And he said, go ahead, Gomer. He said, those are your girls, those are your friends. Maybe you get a chance to tell them about God and how God loves them. And so I put on my shoes again, and I got my jewelry again, and I practiced my dancing again so I could go out with them. We had a nice time. But this time when I came home, I just thought, this is where I belong. This is where I know that I'm worth something. This is where I know that I have value. And so I just want to encourage you, my children, you need to be quiet while I'm preaching. I just want to encourage you, my three kids, right there, 1, 2, 3, I told you. I just want to encourage you that if you do not believe that God loves you, if you believe that God has to have you be holy, holy, holy to know God, you're wrong, that God wants you back, that God will pay any price to have you back, and that applies to to us as people, but it also applies to whole nations of people. So be encouraged. God is looking for you. God wants to have you back. God wants to have this nation back as well. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Give us a glimpse of the kingdom you are bringing to earth when death and violence and hunger will be no more, and when all nations gather in the light of your presence. Teach us peace that we may plow up the battlefields, pound weapons into building tools, and learn to talk across old boundaries as brothers and sisters in love. Creator God, renew our nation. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Draw us together as one people who do your will, so that we may be a light to our nation, leading the way to your promised kingdom, which even now is coming among us. Great God, renew this nation. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. The table is prepared. Please come.
Thank you.
allow us to your table, even when we might betray you. God, we ask that you would be with us and help us to just grow into better disciples and be a light to this nation. Please receive our offering as an expression of thanks for all that you do in our lives. We pray in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Cindy, you can remain standing. Cindy Tanner. We have for the next couple Sundays, the next two Sundays, some folks talking to us about financial stewardship with the church. We're just headed into pledge season, so we thought we'd start off with a bang with Cindy.
Geez, I was going to kind of go for the, maybe do it next week. Shall we give the long version, the short version? What do you guys want, long version or short version? Raise your hand like this if you can't see it. So how about this? How about I'll give you the short version and promise to come back some other time and give you the long version. Does that work for everybody?
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm here to talk about stewardship, right? So raise your hand if you've heard this before. Stewardship, what it is, what it's all about. Don't worry, if you don't raise your hand, I'm not going to call on you if you do raise it. So it's about giving, right? So you've heard it a lot of different ways. Sometimes for a few of you, it's the first time you've heard it. But it's about giving. In my long version, I have all kinds of examples and things to show you. And I might even borrow those fancy shoes and those earrings I saw going by earlier. But we're not there yet. Right? We're not there yet. So it's about giving. So in my mind, what I was going to talk to you guys about is what's the what of stewardship and giving, what's the how can you be a part of it, and what's the why. And so I think what's most important, because we'll go through the long version later of more of the what and more of the how, it's the why. And if I just jump to the end, ready for you, jump to the end of the why is stewardship important to me? And why do I give? I give for you. And you have to think about that for a moment, because I thought, why do I give? Well, gee, we want the lights to be on, we want a sanctuary, we want Pastor Rachel and her family and our musicians, everybody taken care of. But why I really give, and this is really selfish, but I think you have to take care of yourself too. I feel good when I give. Bottom line, that's why I do it. So sometimes it's money, sometimes it's a pledge, sometimes it's volunteering, sometimes it's mopping the floors when you do it, you don't want to. So I'm going to leave you guys with a challenge. Because remember, I got the long version of all of that some other point in time. But I'm going to leave you guys with a challenge. Challenge yourselves to do something more. It could be money. At one point I said, every time I see money on the ground, in the bush, blowing in the wind, I'm going to pick it up and save it and throw it in the offering tin on Sunday. Sometimes, maybe I'll challenge you, every Sunday, put a prayer in the offering. Pray for the utility bill. Pray for our new thermostats. Pray for us as a community. Give something because it feels good. And if you want to throw in little trinkets that you find, maybe you find little bracelets or little necklaces or find little trinkets, we'll do something with that. If you're out in the woods hiking and you come across some rocks and people put things on it, whether they're doing little prayers and little offerings, I promise you, you'll do something with whatever you put in there. And I also promise you, it will feel good for you. So I give, not only because I want to, but it makes me feel good. So I challenge each one of you to do the same. Make yourself feel good. Not so much to ask, right? Thanks, guys. Long version another time.
Yeah, that's one of the blessings we get back, for sure, when we give, is a feeling of satisfaction. All right, a few announcements for you. We are selling May mission wreaths this month. They are coming in after Thanksgiving, that Saturday. We have sold them for a number of years now and are just so happy because it gives us a chance to tell people about our May mission trip that we do every summer and how we like to support the wreath makers up in that part of the country in Maine by buying your wreaths at a fair value and then supporting the mission up there and supporting our church. So I want you to buy a wreath if you use wreaths and you're decorating. And if you do or don't, we really want you to tell your friends about it because it gives you a chance to say, hey, my church goes up to Maine and does, you know, construction work on people's homes for a week every single summer. And just that story is a powerful story to tell. So sell the wreaths to your friends, to your family, buy them as gifts, buy them yourselves. We can take orders through about the Sunday before Thanksgiving. And thank you. on this Friday, the Velociraptor Youth Group is going to play Monster Mini Golf. For carpool purposes, we need to know who is going, and there's a sign-up sheet back on the clipboards in the hallway across from the TV screen. Please sign up there. The next night, Saturday, is Sisterhood at Joni Tarbox's house at 7 p.m., and all ladies are invited to go to that. On Thursday, the 17th, we are having our annual meeting, a church conference. It is called by our district superintendent, our supervisor, to come and see how the business of the church has been going over the last year. That is on Thursday the 17th at 7 p.m. Everyone is invited to come. If you need to submit a report, I have already emailed you. I emailed you last night. So if you didn't get one, good for you. And if you did, turn it back in by next Monday, please, to me. And the last thing is, in 2 weeks from now, is our Thanksgiving in-gathering. That's a day that we just say thank you to God for everything that God has given to us. And we do that by bringing gifts for the food pantry. And we do that by bringing our pledge cards back. And so Cindy's talking was the first piece in thinking about why we give and how we give. Next Sunday, we'll also hear a little bit more about that. But maybe 2 weeks for you, Cindy. We'll talk about that. I love it. Okay. She had said she was going to have a hula skirt and tap shoes. I am so disappointed.
How could I compare?
So these are the announcements. I think that Norma had a celebration.
Yes. I want to thank everyone who had anything and everything to do with the fair. You know, many hands, does make life work, and it also created a lot of laughs, I think, over the past couple of days. I think it was a wonderful fair. As much as I dreaded it, I enjoyed it yesterday and the day before. We do have lots of rolls to sale, I believe, Camille?
Yeah. Right.
And we do have two or three chicken pot pies for sale. There are also some candy cane salmon jars up there if you'd like to purchase one of those. So again, my sincere thanks to anyone and everyone. I appreciate it. And trustees, Tuesday night.
Thank you, yes. So Norma, I wonder if you would come up here. This is a little bit of a joke, but we have to thank Norma for the great work that she did coordinating the fair, because it's so much work and it's one of our major fundraisers. But there's a little backstory, and I'm going to be quick because we're late and we're hungry. At the Taste of North Reading about a month ago, there was a gift basket that was won, and the person who won it said, I have no use for any of these things. Can you use it for the fair? So we gave it to Norma, and she said, I'll put it in the fair. And then it was won again in that raffle, and the person who won it said, I have no use for anything in this basket.
Oh, dear.
And so Norma. May God who searches for us, who looks for us when